Hello friends, welcome to our channel Chemistry with SK. In today's session, we'll see the MCQs of Engineering Chemistry part from Pune University syllabus, and the name of chapter is Fuels. Unit number 4, Fuels. A good fuel has following calorific value and ignition point. So, as the calorific value and ignition point is asked, it means we should know that the fuel should have higher calorific value. But what about ignition temperature or ignition point? It is the temperature, it is the minimum temperature at which fuel starts combustion. So we may think that it should be minimum, it should be maximum, but remember that it should be more moderate. I will explain you with the three examples. Let us consider about the solid fuels, liquid fuels and gaseous fuels. Solid fuels are having very higher ignition temperature, very high. The liquids are having moderate, and gaseous fuels are having very small ignition temperature. If you have to burn the wood, solid wood, then the matchstick may not be sufficient, but if you have to lighten the kerosene stove, then the matchstick is sufficient. But when we have to lighten the gas burner, in that case just the lighter is sufficient, because even a single spark of lighter can ignite the fuel. It means gaseous fuels are in very lower ignition temperature, and this is risky, and therefore this should not be there, and the fuel should have moderate ignition temperature. So ignition temperature should be moderate, and this combination is given in the option number 2. Why sulfur percentage in coal is of bad quality? We should know the reason. From school levels we are learning that sulfur produces some pollutants like sulfur dioxide. Sulfur dioxide can be converted into sulfur trioxide. So such type of pollutants are liberated, and that's why it is of bad quality. So it no problem of calorific value. It doesn't decrease or increase calorific value, not forming volatile matter, but it is forming some sulfur oxides like SO2 and SO3. So answer for this question should be D, the last. A higher volatile matter in coal causes. If volatile matter is present in more quantity, then we should remember that there is elongation in the flame length. Suppose this is a flame. So the flame length is elongated. Okay, it means this can be the right answer. But we should see the other options also. Pollution in air. Yes, there is a pollution because volatile matter passes into atmosphere without combustion, and pollution is taking place. Why decreases calorific value? Because it is getting escape into atmosphere without combustion. It means it is we are losing that calorific value also. And pollution is also there. It means all the three options are correct. How it is possible? So answer is the last, all of these. Okay, so answer should be this. Now when we talk about the warm calorimeter, we know that the acid correction, fusor correction, cooling correction, etc. are the corrections for having accurate formula for gross calorific value. So acid correction should be added or subtracted or multiplied or divided during the calculation of GCV. So you should remember that acid correction and fusor correction have to be subtracted, because what is the formula? We should remember the formula at GCV is equal to capital W plus small w into T2 minus T1 divided by X. This is the formula. After correction, the formula becomes minus A, that is acid correction. Acid correction and fusor correction have to be subtracted. It means the formula is in this way. And cooling correction is to be added. So cooling correction we write here as T into dt. So what is asked about? It is asked about the acid correction, and acid correction needs to be subtracted. So this second should be the answer. Before refining of petroleum, the emulsified water in crude oil is removed by. As you should remember that the refining of petroleum, that is purification, or we can say fractional distillation, there are three steps. In the first step, we are removal of water. In the second step, we are removing sulfur. And in the third step, there is actual fractional distillation or fractionation. Okay, so fractionation can be there. So before refining of petroleum, the emulsified water in the crude oil, that is this first step, it is removed by which process? So you must remember, you might remember that the Cotterell's process is there. The next question is, before refining of petroleum, sulfur is removed from crude oil. Yes, we have discussed. So here recently I have discussed that copper oxide is to be added, because sulfur, if it is present, then we are adding copper oxide and then copper sulfide is being formed. So copper and sulfur, this is formation of copper sulfide and oxygen is released. So in this way, the answer should be A. The next is, warm calorimeter is used for measuring the calorific value of. You should remember that warm calorimeter is for measurement of solid and liquid fuels, and Boyle's calorimeter is only for gaseous fuels and highly volatile liquid fuels. So you remember, and accordingly, the solid and volatile liquid, no, volatile, no, it should not be there. Solid and non-volatile liquid, yes, I think it is correct, but we should see options. Solid and liquid fuels, actually this is also solid and liquid fuels, solid and liquid fuels. So option A, B, C are almost same, but some specifications are given here, so C cannot be correct. And D is liquid and gaseous fuels. Actually, this is to be done by using Boyle's calorimeter, right? Boyle's calorimeter. We have been asked for the Baum calorimeter. So, answer should be the second. Boyle's gas calorimeter determines. Recently, I have seen the Boyle's gas calorimeter is there, and that can determine. So, GCV at constant volume, GCV at constant pressure, NCV at constant pressure, and NCV at constant volume. So when we are talking about Boyle's gas calorimeter, so we are maintaining the uniform pressure of the gas around 3 to 4 liters. You might have seen it in the theory that we are burning the gas CS fuel at the uniform rate of 3 to 4 liters per minute. It means it is to be maintained at constant pressure. We have to identify the correct formula for Baum calorimeter. So we have recently seen the formula. No, actually why this is not the formula? This could be the formula for, this A could be formula for Boyle's calorimeter, but here X is given, it means it is not correct. The C is not correct. So the B is W into W T2 minus T1 upon X. I think this is correct, but we should see about the last option. Here it is T2 plus T1 is mentioned. So we remember the formula, it should be T2 minus T1. Combustion method is used for determination of dash dash in ultimate analysis of coal. So combustion method, as we remember, the combustion method is for mainly carbon and hydrogen, because you might remember that we are burning the coal sample, the carbon which is present there, that is converted into CO2. Okay, it means carbon is converted into CO2 and hydrogen is converted into H2O, and these vapors are allowed to pass through U-shaped tubes. Okay, the next question is, crude oil contains mainly, as you know that petroleum or crude oil contains mainly the alkanes, cycloalkanes, branched-chain alkanes, asphaltenes, etc. But mainly that are containing the alkanes. During the GCV determination, the products of combustion are cooled too. So we know that as per definition, we are cooling it at 15 degrees Celsius. It means that maximum amount of heat that is getting escaped into atmosphere, that is collected and cooled to 15 degrees Celsius. So 15 degrees Celsius plus, as you know, 273, it becomes 288 Kelvin, and that's why the answer should be 288. For percentage volatile matter determination in proximate analysis of coal, the coal has to be heated for 7 minutes at digest temperature. So you must remember the temperatures. As you know, in proximate analysis, the firstly we are talking about moisture, right? Moisture, then there is volatile matter, and the next is ash content. So, moisture, for moisture content, the heating is to be done at 110 degrees Celsius. Volatile matter, it is 925 degrees Celsius. And for ash, the 750 degrees Celsius. Here, plus minus 5 degree. Here, plus minus 25 degrees Celsius. And here also, plus minus 25 degrees Celsius can be correct. The volatile matter is asked, and volatile matter is having 925 degrees Celsius. So 925 should be the answer, and that's why second is the correct answer. Alright. The next is, fractionation of crude oil involves the separation of fractions on the basis of. As you know that when the fractionating column is there, okay. As you know, there is a fractionating column and it is having some compartments. So here, the crude oil gets separated. It means there is a fractional distillation. So on the basis of what that occurs? So as it is distillation, it is on the basis of boiling point differences. So differences in boiling point, the first is correct. Second, difference in melting point, no. Difference in density and difference in molecular weight. So answer A is correct. Here the question is simple, that so its boiling point is asked. So you should remember, as recently we have seen this particular example, that the heavy oil, kerosene, naphtha, etc., etc. So you must remember these fractions, the name of these fractions and the boiling points. It is very easy to remember their boiling fractions. So gasoline is having the boiling point in the range of 60 to 120. It means answer can be the second. Gross calorific value is the amount of heat liberated when unit mass or unit volume of fuel is burned completely. And it means you might know that about the definitions. There are mainly three terms. First is calorific value, where the definition of calorific value is this, that given two sentences. And when you have to write about the gross calorific value, then and ke baad mein kya aayega, and the products of combustion are cooled to 15 degrees Celsius, if you remember. Okay, let us see the options. Products of combustion escape with some heat. If they are escaping some heat, then it is not gross calorific value, that can be net calorific value. The products of combustion are cooled to 15 degrees Celsius and some additional heat is collected. Yes, this is right. Products of combustion are ignored. So that is not correct, and none of these. Okay. So answer should be the second. As we have seen the question, that diesel is obtained in the boiling point range and the carbon atoms. It means you have to write about the carbon atoms and the boiling point of diesel. So you must remember heavy oil, then diesel, kerosene, naphtha, etc. So if you are remembering them in sequence, so diesel is having the boiling point of 250 to 320 degrees Celsius, and number of carbon atoms are C16 to C18. It means which can be the correct options? The second is correct option. Okay. In ultimate analysis, to determine percentage of carbon and hydrogen, the water vapors are allowed to pass through. As you know, ultimate analysis is there, and for determination of carbon and hydrogen, there are two U-tubes, U-shaped tubes. We have seen in the previous part, in one of the previous questions. So the first U-tube contains calcium chloride or magnesium perchlorate. Second contains KOH. But we should see what is asked. The water vapors are asked. It is asked about the water vapors. That H2 vapors are allowed to pass through what? So H2 vapors are allowed to pass through the first U-tube, which may contain calcium chloride or magnesium perchlorate. It means A and B both are correct. So answer is C. Okay. You should read the options carefully. The Jeldahl's method is used for determination of dash dash in ultimate analysis of coal. So you might remember that hydrogen, for hydrogen there is a combustion method. For nitrogen there is a Jeldahl's method. It means Jeldahl method, nitrogen. Sulfur by Esca method. Okay. You should remember this ESCHKA. So answer should be second. Here, this question is somewhat confusing. Latent heat of water, we remember the values 587 and we immediately click on these options. But we should see the units also. It is joule per gram, it is not correct. Calorie per gram it could be, then it could be correct. But it is calorie per kilogram. So here it should not be kilogram. It could be calorie per gram. So this is also not correct. So if you convert this, then it will be equivalent to 2450, that is kilojoules per kilogram. You can see 587 calorie per gram. So calorie is to be converted into joules and then into kilojoules. So we know that multiplication factor is 4.184. It is for making joules, and for kilojoules again 10^-3. Per kilogram, it means 10^-3 gram to kilogram. So this and this will get cancelled, and this answer should be there. So answer is D, last. The maximum temperature reached for burning a fuel is called as. Here minimum temperature is not asked. It is asked about maximum temperature. So ignition temperature is the minimum temperature, right? So it is not the answer.
Fusion means melting temperature.
Calorific value the calorific intensity is the right option for maximum temperature, right? Most of the chemical fuels contain major heat liberating elements. So the major heat liberating elements are carbon and hydrogen. Okay, so carbon and hydrogen are the mainly constituents of hydrocarbons and alkanes. Okay, the next is GCV and NCV. The relation between GCV and NCV, you might remember that formula. NCV is equal to GCV minus is mentioned here. Okay, so you know that it is the formula GCV is equal to NCV plus 0.09 into H into latent heat, that is 587 calorie per gram or kilocalorie per kilogram, one and the same. So here this term is asked and accordingly the answer is 0.095. So A cannot be right, and D is 0.09 H. So answer is the last. Net calorific value is the heat liberated when unit mass or unit volume of fuel. We have seen the definition for GCV in the similar fashion. Now it is about the NCV. So this is the definition for calorific value, and we have to write the definition of calorific value, then and then we have to continue. So what we have to continue? The products of combustion are allowed to escape with some heat. Yes, it is correct. It means the products of combustion escape with some heat. Products of combustion are cooled. No, that are not cooled. Products of combustion are separated for treatment. No, and none of these. So answer is A. So paraffinic based petroleum contains mainly alkanes are present in maximum quantity. So that are saturated hydrocarbons. So I think this should be the right answer. Naphthalenes, aromatics, and none of these. Mainly the major component is of alkanes. It means we can say saturated hydrocarbons. So it should be answer as A. Refining of petroleum means, as we know, the refining means what? Purification. I think it is right. Fractional cooling of petroleum vapors. Yes, I think right. All, it means I should see. What about the option C? Crystallization. Now what mistake you may make here, if you see here all, it means you may think that this is also correct, but no, this is not correct. The crystallization, there is no crystallization during the refining. The vapors of fuel are converted into liquid, okay, and there is no any crystal formation. So C cannot be right. It means out of A and B, which is more correct? So B is more correct, A is not correct, right? So option can be second, fractional cooling. Here you should remember the units of calorific value for various types of fuels, solid fuels, liquid fuels, and gaseous fuels. The unit should be remembered. So it is a memory based question, as it is the joules per meter cube. That can be the SI unit for gaseous fuels. The standard gross calorific value of naphthalene is, you may think that where the answer for this particular question is available. So this is based on bomb calorimeter. Okay, this is a question from bomb calorimeter. As you know, we have the formula that GCV is equal to W plus small w into T2 minus T1. If you have to find out the value of this small w, we should take the fuel of non-calorific value, and that is said to be standard calorific value or standard gross calorific value. So the values you may remember here for naphthalene, the value is 9622. So there are only four values and four chemicals, four main molecules are there, like camphor, naphthalene, benzoic acid. So you should see that. So the answer is C, memory based question. The sulfur in the coal in the experiment for finding sulfur percentage get finally converted to. So whether you remember or not, there are two options. If you remember the reaction, then you can directly write that barium sulfate is formed as a precipitate. Don't confuse barium chloride and barium sulfate. Barium sulfate should be answer. If you don't remember the reaction, then you can remember the formula. So what is given in the formula? That formula is sulfur percentage is equal to weight of barium sulfate form, right? So this is the formula, barium sulfate. It means from this also we can get information, or we can recall that barium sulfate is formed. So answer should be the last, D. A very good question, sir. The gas liberated in the experiment to find out nitrogen percentage in coal. So when we are determining the nitrogen percentage from coal, which molecules are formed? Nitrogen No, ammonia, yes, ammonia is formed, CO2 and CO is not formed. So ammonia is formed. So instrument which is used for measurement of calorific value. So what is that instrument? Calorimeter, potentiometer, calorimeter and thermometer. So calorimeter and calorimeter, what is difference between these two? So the calorimeter is for study of visible spectroscopy, and calorimeter is useful for measurement of calorific value. Okay, the process of converting higher hydrocarbons to lower one. Actually, sometimes you may feel that these are irrelevant questions, but you should recall these things. The process of conversion of higher hydrocarbons into smaller one, because as we have seen, in case of refining of petroleum, the higher fractions are formed. Lower heavy oil, etc. If you see, there is presence of C16 to C18, such type of compositions may be there. It means this long chain hydrocarbons may be converted into smaller ones, and that can be called as, so pyrolysis, no, that is called as cracking. Okay. Thermometer used to record temperature in bomb calorimeter, digest thermometer used, Berger, Beckham and Beckman. Which one? The Beckman thermometer or digital thermometer. Okay, the next is velocity of combustion for good quality fuel should be. Now, velocity of combustion, as we are talking about the characteristics of ideal fuel or good fuel, which fuel can be considered as ideal fuel, whether the velocity of combustion should be higher or lower, or it should be moderate. You may say it should be moderate, but not the answer. It should be mainly controllable. Okay. If you have to increase the speed, then it can be increased. If you have to minimize it, we could, and that's why it should be controllable. Volatile matter is the matter produced from fuel due to incomplete oxidation of fuel. No, thermal decomposition of fuel. Okay, maybe products formed due to lesser supply of air. So no volatile matter is formed here, and all of these. So all of these cannot be right. And the answer is second, that thermal decomposition of fuel. It means due to thermal decomposition of fuel, there is formation of volatile matter. So next question is, which of following has property of absorbing CO2? Yes, it is an ultimate analysis. We should remember ultimate analysis of coal. Carbon and hydrogen. So you know that if hydrogen is there, then it is converted into H2, and at H2 vapors are absorbed by calcium chloride in the first U2, and the carbon is converted into CO2, and that is absorbed by KOH solution in the second U2. It means here CO2 is asked, so we should write about the options are calcium chloride, magnesium perchlorate, concentrated H2SO4 and KOH solution. So answer should be last, KOH solution. Which of following is a secondary chemical fuel? Now it is a very simple question, that types of fuels. As you know that there are mainly two types, primary fuel and secondary fuel. Primary fuels are again subdivided into three types, solid, liquid and gaseous fuels and secondary. So primary are natural fuels and secondary are derived fuels. So petroleum is primary fuel and petrol is secondary fuel. Vegetable oil is again primary fuel. Natural gas,
it is natural means primary.
So secondary fuel is petrol. Which of the following is not a chemical fuel? Chemical fuel kutla nahi hai. So coal, petroleum, LPG. Chemical fuel means fossil fuel. So all fossil fuels are called as chemical fuels. Here the uranium is not a chemical fuel because it is nuclear fuel. So uranium is the answer. Which of surplus fractions catalytically crack to produce products of demand? Products of demand may be like petrol. How to prepare the petrol? So it can be obtained by cracking the higher hydrocarbon. Because if you remember the various fractions, the here the residue is there, and here there is the heavy oil, diesel, kerosene, naphtha, etc. Okay. So here the answer is heavy oil.
Because the heavy oil contains maximum carbon atoms, so it can be broken to smaller ones, and the required smaller products can be obtained.
Ethyl alcohol is manufactured commercially by the preparation of ethyl alcohol. So there are various reactions. You know that the sugar in sugar factory is from the sucrose, or we can say the molasses, and molasses contains sugar. So the sugar or sucrose or starch, that can be the various reactions where commercial preparation of ethyl alcohol can be possible. The enzyme which converts glucose and fructose into ethyl alcohol is, now here you must remember the two reactions. When there is a sugar or sucrose that is converted into glucose plus fructose, and this glucose and fructose are converted into ethyl alcohol. So which enzymes are used here? You might remember that here invertase enzyme is used for this, and in this case the zymase is used. It means zymase is used here. And what is asked? The glucose and fructose is converted into ethyl alcohol. It means the second reaction is asked. So in the second part we have to write about this zymase. Okay, this zymase, and answer should be the zymase. The next question is 100% alcohol is also called as. So 100% alcohol is called as absolute alcohol. Okay, it is not power alcohol. Mainly we write as power alcohol, but power alcohol is not the absolute alcohol, or we can say 100% alcohol. If 5 to 25% of ethyl alcohol is present in petrol, then it is called as power alcohol. So answer is C, absolute alcohol. All other conditions being equal, the largest volume is occupied by LPG, hydrogen, natural gas and CNG. So what can be the logic? Yes, go to schools. You know that hydrogen is the smallest gas, or we can say it is having the minimum molecular weight, just 2 gram. And according to Avogadro's law, it will occupy 22.4 liters of volume. 1 mole of any gas occupies 22.4 liters of volume. It means maximum volume will be occupied by hydrogen gas, because it is smallest in weight, and it will require maximum volume. So answer should be second. Biodiesel is obtained from biodiesel. How to obtain biodiesel? So biological decomposition? No, not directly. Crude oil? No. Vegetable oil? Yes, it is obtained from crude oil and methyl acetate. It means according to the options we have to identify, it is obtained from vegetable oils. Or biodiesel is superior in performance compared to diesel. Why biodiesel is superior in performance? Because, well, let us see the options. Biodiesel and diesel, let us have a comparison. It causes negligible air pollution. Yes, it is right. It has higher C10 number value. Actually C10 number is not for present syllabus to you, but the more the C10 number, better is the quality of that particular fuel, and it is good. So it is desirable that higher C10 number value. Yes, biodiesel is also having higher C10 number, so this is also right. It is renewable. So you know that generally biodiesel is prepared by using jatropha plants or jatropha trees, and therefore all of these is the answer. It is renewable also. The next is, biodiesel is substitute fuel for IC engines too. Biodiesel can be substituted for diesel. Catalyst used in manufacture of biodiesel: sodium methoxide, platinum, nickel, FeO. So sodium methoxide, CNG. What about CNG? Whether it is highly polluting, less polluting, not at all polluting, and none of these. So what do you think? Compressed natural gas, CNG, it is polluting minimum, less pollution. So answer should be second here. CNG is a dry natural gas which is compressed to high pressure about 1000 atmosphere. Actually it is the right answer. Compressed to high pressure and liquefied. No, it is not liquefied. So A or B, either is mentioned, it is incorrect, and none of these. So answer is A. Okay. CNG powered vehicle requires ... than gasoline powered vehicles. If you want to use CNG as a in vehicles, then there is a more requirement of space, okay, than gasoline. Gasoline means petrol. For petrol there is a requirement of smaller space. So space here requirement. So answer option C, greater amount of space is required for CNG powered vehicles. So there is a numerical. Find percentage of carbon and hydrogen in coal if 0.25 gram of coal on combustion shows increase in weight of calcium chloride due to, and KOH-2 is given. So you should remember the formula. Here we have to find out the carbon and hydrogen. Actually in the present data, the carbon and hydrogen both are asked, but in your examination for this particular semester during pandemic, this question will be asked in fractions, because the weightage of this question is only for 1 mark as per your exam pattern. But this weightage is of 2 marks. So only half part of India will be asked, either carbon or hydrogen. So formula for carbon, the main thing is you must remember the formula. carbon percentage is equal to weight of CO2 form, weight of CO2 form upon initial weight of coal sample, right? Initial weight of coal multiplied by 12 upon 44 into 100. So this can be the formula for carbon percentage. So weight of CO2, weight of CO2 means whether it is weight of calcium chloride U2 or whether KOH U2. Just tell me. Yes, because carbon dioxide is absorbed by KOH. So KOH U2 is increasing, or we can say there is increase in mass of KOH U2 by 0.5 gram. So we should write the options values here. 0.5 divided by initial weight of coal sample, it is given as 0.25. okay, then multiplied by 12 upon 44 and multiplied by 100. So calculate this, how much it is coming?
So answer is 54.55.
molar ratio of alcohol to triglyceride required to complete transesterification reaction. So how much is the ratio? Triglyceride, molar ratio of alcohol to triglyceride, alcohol to triglyceride, it means this to this ratio, it is 3:1. Okay, so answer should be second. The byproduct obtained in the preparation of biodiesel is glycerol, is formed as a byproduct, you might remember, right? Main component of CNG, compressed natural gas. So the methane and ethane are the major components of CNG. Transesterification reaction is obtaining biodiesel makes use of catalyst. So in transesterification reaction, which type of catalyst is used? It whether acidic catalyst, basic catalyst, biocatalyst, or any of this. So as you know, there is use of sodium methoxide as a catalyst, CH3ONa. So it is the basic catalyst, and therefore answer should be written as CH base catalyst. We are at the last few questions, and mainly the numericals. So let us see the numericals. Actually, I'm not explaining it to you in very detail because you already known the theory. This is just for a practice, and that's why I am taking this as fast. So a coal sample weighing 1 gram loses 0.09 gram. It means loss in weight is directly given. As per our formula, we have to find out the moisture, and as per our formula, the moisture percentage is equal to loss in weight. Alright, so loss in weight divided by initial weight of coal sample into 100, that is our formula. We write this formula in another way, that m minus m1 upon m into 100. But here, which one is m and which one is m1? So you should read it properly. 1 gram is the initial amount of coal and it loses 0.09 gram. It means loss in weight is directly given. Okay, so we have to write the loss in weight, and that value is to be written as 0.09 upon 1 gram as weight of coal sample multiplied by 100. So how much it is coming? Yes, 9%. And that's why the option should be second. Many times what happens, what students make the mistake? Here they may subtract m minus m1, they consider that this is the final weight. It means they do it as 1 minus 0.09, and such type of mistake is observed. You should read it properly what is given. The loss in weight is directly given. So the moisture is 9%. A coal has GCB equal to 7800 calorie per gram and 4% hydrogen. Its net calorific value will be, so as you know the formula, GCV is equal to, okay, what is the formula? GCV is equal to NCV plus 0.09 into H into latent heat, that is 587. So we have to just put the values. NCV, how much NCV is given? It is, okay, GCV is given as 7800, right? It means we have to just put the value 7800. And we have to find out net calorific value. 4% hydrogen is there. Okay, we'll put the value 0.09 into 4 into 587. So we have to just calculate it. So here the calculations are given, and you can see The main thing is you should be able to put the values, substitute the values, and then the answer can be written properly. So here the answer can be 7588. That option is second, and this is the answer. Coal contains 5% hydrogen. Net calorific value is also based on the same formula. It means GCV is to be calculated here. I have written it as GCV is to be calculated, NCV, and this formula. So NCV value is given as 5320, and then 5% hydrogen, it means here 5% hydrogen and the rest of the things. So you just calculate this, and the answer is this C. A fuel has calorific value of 10,000 calorie per gram, and its SI conversion should be, actually its SI unit conversion is expected. So you know that the SI unit is joules per kilogram, right? Joules per kilogram is the conversion in the SI unit. The 10,000 calorie per gram is equal to 10,000 multiplied by 4.18, that is into joules per kilogram. The calorie per gram converts into joules. It means just we have converted calorie into joules by this term 4.18. Gram is to be converted into kilogram. So 10 raised to minus 3, and then it becomes 10 raised to 3. Okay. So actually this is the way I have given. You can check your own calculations and you can verify option A is the correct answer. Here a liquid fuel contains 10% hydrogen. Actually, now you can solve this because it is based on the same formula, GCV and CV relation, and I think many questions can be asked. Here the difference in GCV and LCV is asked. It means the difference between GCV and LCV, it means we have to find out the value of GCV minus NCV. So you have to just rearrange the formula. So that is equal to 0.09 into H into latent heat. This latent heat is given in the another unit, doesn't matter, you have to consider this unit, and that's why the final unit also will be same. So just these multiplications have to be done, and accordingly the answer is coming to be 2205. So option C. Net calorific value is 7000 calorie per gram. GCV is to be calculated. The same formula, GCV is equal to NCV into this plus this one. Actually, this should have the bracket, okay? You know it. So 7000, 5% of hydrogen is there. So 5 into 5 is 7. So accordingly, 7 to 64, it is coming. 7 to 64, and the option is last. Now it is on bomb calorimeter. You know the formula for bomb calorimeter, 0.5 gram of coal. Actually, we should remember the formula and we should be able to put the values. So as the formula is there, W plus W into T2 minus T1 upon X. So we have to put the values. 0.5 gram of coal sample. It means X is equal to 0.5. Then 1.5 is the rise in temperature. Okay, 1.5 degree rise in temperature is there. And if total water equivalence of calorimeter set including water is set, it is 2400 gram. We know that this is required in kilogram. So here the value of W plus W is given. This both W's are given here as 2400 gram. And then gross calorific value is to be calculated. It means just we have to find out this. So you just calculate. Calculators are allowed to you. So use it properly. And answer is 7200 second. It is on Boyle's calorimeter. GCV of gaseous fuel was found to be 15,000. Okay, GCV is 15,000 kilocalorie per meter cube. If mass of steam condense, it means small m, we should be able to put the values. Small m is 0.02 kilogram. How much fuel is used or burnt? It means V. V is the volume of fuel burnt, and it is 0.1. So V is the volume of gaseous fuel, and it is 0.1 meter cube. Latent heat of condensation is given as 587, and NCV is to be asked. So here we don't have to use the regular formula of GCV and NCV, 0.09H, the previous formula which I have seen, that is not to be used here, because here when the mass of steam condensed is to be is given, then we have to use this particular formula. So GCV, NCV, these values are to be put into formula. NCV is to be rearranged. NCV can be calculated by rearranging the data. So GCV is equal to 15,000 m, the mass is 0.02 into pi T7 divided by volume 0.1, and that's it. So it is coming to be 1482. Option last. Coal contains 10% moisture. Okay. 1 gram of coal loses 0.3 gram weight on heating at 925 degrees Celsius in absence of air. The percentage of volatile matter in the coal will be. It means coal contains 10% moisture. And when 1 gram of coal is being heated, that loses. Loss is directly given, 0.3 gram. It means 0.3 gram is there. So we can say at 925 degrees Celsius. So we can say the volatile matter is there. The mass is, the loss in weight is 0.3 divided by 1 multiplied by 100 minus moisture percentage. As you know, there are two formulae for the volatile matter percentage. If we are using the moisture free coal sample, and if we are containing the moisture free moisture containing coal sample and moisture free coal sample, so it is the second formula. If moisture is given there, moisture is present, the coal contains 10% moisture, so that is to be subtracted for getting volatile matter, because here directly heating is being done at 925 degrees Celsius. So 0.3 multiplied by 100, that is coming to be 30%, and 30 minus this moisture is 10%, so answer is 20%. So 20% should be the volatile matter. Now, a very simple question is there. A coal sample contains 75% carbon, 5% hydrogen, 1% sulfur, 2%. Okay. And oxygen in the coal is to be identified. So, it is very simple formula. We remember, we all know that oxygen is to be calculated. As it is ultimate analysis, how to calculate oxygen percentage? 100 minus all these percentages to be considered. So, 100 minus all these percentages. Carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, sulfur, ash, etc. 100 minus addition of all these, and that is coming to be 7%. It means 7% is oxygen. 0.25 gram of coal sample on burning in and current of pure oxygen was found to increase weight of CaCl2U2 by 0.08 gram. So this is only one question. Only one part is asked, that is about carbon and hydrogen. So you know that as carbon and hydrogen are the two parts, only one part is asked, and hydrogen. So we know that the formula for hydrogen, that weight of moisture upon or weight of H2O form upon weight of coal into 2 upon 18 into 100. So weight of moisture, how much moisture is formed, that is the increase in weight of calcium chloride U2, that is 0.08. So we should put the 0.08 divided by 0.25 as in initial weight of coal sample, 2 upon 18, and as it is, so it is coming to be 3.11%. In this way, you have to calculate. 3.11 should be the answer. 2.02 gram of coal is burnt in combustion tube on passing O2 increases the weight of KOH. You know that CO2, if it is there, then there is increase in weight of KOH U2. So we can say the formula is carbon percentage equal to weight of CO2 form upon initial weight of coal sample into 12 upon 44 into 100. So just put the values. Increase in weight of KOH U2 is 5.88 gram. So 5.88 divided by 2.02 as the initial weight of coal sample, and rest of the things are, so you have to just calculate this, and that is coming to be 79.39. so answer is this. So guys, that's it for today. So see you again in another video. Thank you.